Hallelujah. You may be seated this morning. Amen. God's an awesome God. Amen. How many's ready for the word? Hallelujah. I said, how many's ready for the word this morning? Hallelujah. See, some of you might think we just sing just to kill some time just before we have preaching, but the worship is what prepares our hearts and our minds. I said minds. It clears us of all the thoughts of the day, the activities of the moment that's going through. It clear, if you do worship the way it's supposed to be done, and you'll enter in and you'll receive from the Lord, I'm here to tell you, He'll clear your mind and your heart, and then your heart is open and it's ready to receive the word of God. How many is ready to receive the word of the Lord today? Amen. I'm excited about today's message. I'm excited about it. God's burned this on my heart this week. And man, I'm telling you, I am just pumped. I'm ready to preach. And I was here at about 7:10 this morning, standing right here, preaching this message to empty seats. But I was speaking to what I believe God is going to do in the service today. You weren't here yet, but God knew you were coming. And so I went ahead and spoke it in advance. So I know what God has to say to you today. Amen. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to, first of all, Jonah chapter 3. And right now we're going to read the first verse. But don't put your Bible away, because I want you to go back with me as soon as we finish reading this to Jonah chapter 1, verse 1. We're going to be looking at that in just a moment. Today I want to talk to you about the God of second chances. The God of second chances. Our text says, now the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time. Did you see that? The second time. Hallelujah. The word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time. I love that. See, I want to set the stage for this message this morning. Jonah is a prophet. Because I'm here to kind of defend Jonah a little bit this morning. Because Jonah has got this bad rap. I mean, it's so easy in the church to preach against or about Jonah. But friend, I want you to understand the story and understand maybe why Jonah said, no, I'm not going to Nineveh. There's more to it than he just said, I don't want to go to Nineveh. And so I want us to set the stage this morning so you'll understand where Jonah was coming from and what happened in the life of Jonah. Jonah is a prophet. A prophet are men who would hear from God and speak the word of God to the people. In Jonah's day, there was about 50 prophets of God. There was about 50 prophets, and most of them dwelled and lived in Jerusalem. Jerusalem is the center of where God was at. It was the temple of God that was filled with the manifest presence of God. And every day Jonah would go to the temple of God and spend time talking to God, spend time in conversation with God, spend time meditating and being in the presence of God. See, I believe it's important this morning that we understand that the word of the Lord is still going forth. I said the word of the Lord is still going forth. He still has men who will stand in the pulpit and preach the word as thus saith the Lord. Not thus saith Springfield, or not thus say Baton Rouge, or thus sayest this place or that place, but will stand in the pulpit and preach the word. Thus saith the Lord. Hallelujah. It's the word of the Lord that God has placed and burned on the heart of the pastor, of the preacher, the prophet, the minister, the teacher, the evangelist, and he preaches it. So God is still speaking to men and women today, because I've heard people say, God don't speak to people no more. Let me tell you something, that's wrong. God is speaking to people. The problem is we're too busy to hear him, or we don't like what he says to us, so we wipe it off and say, he's not speaking to us anymore. But I've come to tell you, if you'll submit yourself to his word, if you'll turn your ears on to what he says to you, if you'll open your heart and your mind to what God says, he will speak to you today. Hallelujah. He'll speak to you today. Hallelujah. I believe if we will simply listen, God's got something to say to us today. In Jonah chapter 1, verse 1, look at this verse. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of the Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah, I'm going to stop there for now, Dale. I'll come back to it. But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. That's what it says. So what is he saying? I'm saying to you this morning that God is still speaking. You see, Jonah had a nickname. Jonah had a reputation. In fact, we've kind of called him, Brother Bob, preachers and people in the church, we call Jonah the reluctant prophet. That's what he's noted for. He's the prophet that ran away from God. In fact, if I ask most of you this morning, tell me a little bit about Jonah, most of you would say something along that line, that Jonah was the prophet of God who ran from God. When God said to him, go to Nineveh, instead he went to Tarshish, or he loaded a ship to go to Tarshish. He's the prophet who was reluctant. How would you like to have that reputation today? How would you like men and women to say that about you? That you are a person who comes to church and you hear the word of God, but because you don't like what God says to you, you become reluctant to obey what God says to you. Oh, it got quiet all of a sudden. See, I was preaching rah-rah, ree-ree, let's do it. Everybody, oh yeah. But when I start bringing it home and knocking at your door and delivering the mail to your house, all of a sudden people get quiet. Which fits into exactly what I'm trying to say. When God speaks to us and we like what he says, we receive it. Oh yeah, go God, go God. We like it. But when God begins to challenge our heart, when God begins to speak to our heart, when God begins to call out things in our heart, all of a sudden, we're no longer re-re-rah-rah. We're no longer cheering, but instead, we're running from God. Hallelujah. Running from God. Thank you. Come on. It's the truth. Doesn't matter if you like it or not. It's the truth. In Facebook, those of you that are social media people, and you're on Facebook, there is this option you have when somebody posts a picture or posts a comment, they say something, and sometimes people say the stupidest things. I'm telling you, you want to see where people's mentality really is, just spend half a day on Facebook. In fact, it won't take that long, and you'll discover. I like the picture I saw one time. It was a clothes hamper. And it said, this is where your dirty laundry goes, not on Facebook. People post every stupid thing you can imagine. Gloom, despair, agony on me, all over it. Drama, 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 all over it. Oh, I'm preaching against Facebook, oh Lord. You say, well, Pastor, you're on Facebook. Look to see if my name's a tag to anything this week. Because I took a break from Facebook. My phone tells me when somebody says something about me or tags me, and I look that up to see what you're saying about me or what you posted about me. Danny posts stuff, and it says, I'm with Pastor, I'm with Gary. And I'm like, I'm not with Danny. He says he's with you. I'm like, I'm not with you. He's miles apart from me. But I always look at it. And I used to always write and always like and always comment, always do that. But I'm taking a break from Facebook because I've learned that I don't need all that drama in my life. I don't need all that. Right now, I want to hear what God says to me, not what you say to me. But there's an option on Facebook that if you like what somebody says, you push like. In fact, now you can hold it down and it gives you these options of different faces. Or what are they called? Emojis? Is that what they're called? Who? Emojis? Yeah, so you know what I know about it. And they got one that's an angry face. It looks like a mad face. It's kind of red. Mad face. And if you say something people don't like, they can put that on there and let you know they didn't like what you said. Well, if I could Facebook Jonah for just a moment and tell you that when God spoke to Jonah in chapter 1, if Jonah would have been on Facebook, he wouldn't have put liked. He would have put the angry face because he did not like what God told him to do. He did not receive it. He did not want to do it. So he began what so many other people who sit in the pews of churches on Sunday morning do. He began to run from the voice of God. Some of you that are sitting here this morning, you started running in 2016. You started running in 2015. Some of you started running in 2014. You get it? 13. God spoke something to you 5 years ago, 10 years ago, and you have yet to submit to what God told you to do. And year after year after year, you bring it into the next year with you, and you're still running from what God spoke to you that he wanted you to get out of your life, or he wanted you to press in into an area of your life. I'm slowing myself down. I want to preach what God said to say, not what Gary said. God has sent me this morning to this pulpit to tell you it's time to stop running from your past and start running into your future. Uh-oh. What? It's time to stop running from your past and start running from your future. Now listen, I hear people tell amen in me, and I want you to amen, but in just a minute, some of you will drop out. In just a minute, some of you that are amening the loudest, all of a sudden you're going to go, oh, wait a minute. He's talking to me now. You see, as long as you think I'm talking to the whole audience, you're okay. But when you realize that God's putting the spotlight on you today, all of a sudden you get quiet. Oh, Lord, give me the strength. See, I have a feeling this morning that there are some Jonahs sitting in this place. I want to show you something today that God showed me. It's in verses 2 and 3 of Jonah. He says to them, arise, go to Nineveh. He said, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. See, God doesn't always tell us things that we like or we want to hear. What do you mean, Pastor? Sometimes when God speaks to you, it isn't necessarily going to be something you want to hear. Or it's not necessarily going to be something that you like. Do you know why Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh? Do you really know why he didn't want to go to Nineveh? First of all, you need to understand Nineveh was the capital city of Assyria. Assyria was a country, a nation that were very barbaric. The people of Nineveh were very barbaric people. Here's what they would do. They would literally go into little bitty towns and cities and communities, and they would literally burn it to the ground, destroy everything there, and they would take the men of the city, the men of the community, the men of the little town, and they would take them, sever their heads from off of their bodies. I don't know about you, but I kind of like this together. I mean, I like it so much that I just skipped the neck and had the head put right on the shoulders. So I asked God for that, and he gave it to me just the way it is. That's not right, is it? They would cut the heads off. So could you imagine this? Here's John's body, and here's his head. Here's Bob's body, and here's his head. Here's Matthew's body, here's his head. Here's Jim's, get the picture? And they would take all of the heads of all of the men that they have killed and severed their heads, and they would build a pyramid out of them outside the city, like where the city line sign that says, "Welcome to Pontu Beach, welcome to Granite City." There would be a pyramid built near that city limit sign, and it would be a constant reminder that the Assyrian people had come through there, and they are troll, they are barbaric, and they'll kill everything in the path. And God says, "Jonah, I want you to go to Nineveh, the capital of where all the barbarics live." And Jonah's like, I know that's what you want me to do, but that's not what I want to do. Because see, sometimes God will speak to you and tell you to do something or say something to you, and you don't want to hear it. You don't like what he says. You don't receive it. And so what you do is you start running from God. Start running. And we're, I know everybody's sitting here, most of you are thinking that we're talking about, yeah, God's talking to you to go to Florida to be a missionary. Well, I'd go to that one, okay? But God's talking to go to Iraq. No, that's not where he's sending me, I can promise you. So we criticize Jonah. We get critical of Jonah. We say, "I can't believe that he would just move, say, I'm not going to listen to you." How many of you sitting here this morning would say, if God spoke to me and said to go to Nineveh, where the capital of Syria, the barbarics, I'll be there. In fact, that land is still the same way today. Because that place that we're talking about, that God sent Jonah to, is today Iraq. Who wants to go to Iraq today? ISIS is all over the land. And you know what they do to people. How many volunteers? We're taking a flight next week. How many want to go to ISIS and to Iraq and to be a witness and say, this is what God says to do? I doubt if we'd have a very many volunteers. And yet we're so critical of Jonah. We jump on the bandwagon and we say, I can't believe Jonah disobeyed God. I can't believe Jonah would flee from God like that. Sounds like a legitimate reason to me not to go to Nineveh. How many would agree with me today that it kind of sounds like a legitimate reason not to go to Nineveh? Be honest. See, so he's gotten a bad rap. All these years, Jonah has gotten this bad rap. See, it's very easy to preach about Jonah running from God and how foolish it was for him to run. Doesn't Jonah know you can't outrun God? Sure he knows he can't outrun God. I mean, if anybody knows how you can't outrun God, it would be Jonah. Why would you say that, Pastor? Because he's a prophet of God. Every day he's gone to the temple. Every day he spends time in the manifest presence of God. He knows that God has an all-seeing eye. He knows that God knows everything, that you cannot escape and you cannot outrun God, my friend. You may go as far as you think you can go, but God still knows where you're at. I remember when my dad worked in the lead mines in Ellington, Missouri. I remember him coming home telling us stories of how he would be way down in the depths of the earth, in the mines down there. But he could still say Jesus and still feel his presence all the way down deep into the heart of the earth. My dad could say you could still sense and feel his presence because, friend, neither David said neither height nor depth or nothing can separate me from the love of God. God's everywhere. Jonah knew. Jonah knew. Jonah understood you couldn't outrun God. So what's he running from? See, Jonah's not running from God because he knows God can't be outrun, but he's running from the presence of God. He's running from the voice of God. See, every day he goes to the temple. Every day he enters into this room where the manifest presence of God is at. And there he soaks in the presence of God, and God speaks to him and he talks to God and they have conversation back and forth. What he's running from, he's not running from God because he knows God can't be outrun from, that God will follow you wherever you go, but he's running from the voice of God, the presence of God. I'm running from the presence of God. Now, people sit here this morning and they're like, yeah, that's good, preacher. I like that. You see, it's the same thing some of you do when God begins to deal with you in your heart and you start running from God. But you don't run, get a boat, and go somewhere. What you do is you just stop coming to church. Because if you don't come to church, then you're not going to hear the preaching. And if you don't have to hear the preaching, then you're not going to be convicted of the sin in your life. And God's, and you're like, hey, if I don't go to the house of God, I won't have to listen to the voice of God. I don't have to be in the presence of God. Oh, I'm preaching better and you're shouting. You see, here's what happens. You come to church. The preacher preaches a word like this. He stirs your heart. He moves you with the message. God speaks to you. And rather than respond and submit, instead you decide, I don't want to hear that. I don't want to listen to that. I like the way I am. I don't want to change the way I am. I like how I'm living. I don't want to change the way. Because if I listen to what the preacher says, that means some things have got to change in my life. So if I don't go to church and I don't hear the preacher, that way I won't hear from God, and then I won't have to make those changes in my life. Ooh. Somebody, please tell me I'm preaching good today. You may not like it, but it's still the truth. It may not be what you want to hear, so put your little angry face on Facebook, okay? But my friend, it's still the truth, whether you like it or not. And not because I'm preaching it, it's because it's the word of the Lord. Because I have to be honest with you. I've run from the voice of God before. I've heard God speak to me and I say, no, 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 God. That's not what I want. Let me tell you, and I'm getting ahead of myself, and that's what I don't want to do. Because I don't want to miss what God has given to me today. And sometimes I do that when I don't stay with my notes. See, I want you to better understand this verse. I saw one translation. How many like to get different translations and read that the same verse but in different versions? I like to hear what different versions say, what they say. It's pretty interesting. I know some like King James, brother. It's King James all the way. It was good enough for the Apostle Paul. It's good enough for me. Just FYI, Paul didn't have a King James Version Bible. Just wanted to let you in on that. Just in case you weren't aware of that, he did not have a King James Bible. But it's a good thought. It's a good thought. So here's one translation. Here's what verse 3 says in another translation. Jonah walked away from the presence of the king. He was in the presence of the king, and the king was speaking to him, and he didn't like what the king said, so he walked away from the presence of the king. That's okay, Mama. I got two mamas. I got Mama Howard and Mama Joyce. I'm doing okay because she's not got her watch out yet, so I'm doing all right. See, Jonah knew God saw him. Jonah knew that God knew where he was. When he got on the boat and headed in the opposite direction, he knew that God knew where he was. Jonah knew that God was everywhere. Jonah did not want to have a face-to-face conversation with God, though. Jonah knew he couldn't outrun God, but was running from the manifest presence of God. You see, Jonah was in Jerusalem when God spoke to him. He was probably in the temple, and God spoke to him to go to Nineveh. And Jonah gets up out of the manifest presence of God that filled the temple and walks away. And he says to himself, I know I can outrun God, but I don't want to talk to God today. And so I'm going to leave Jerusalem. I'm going to walk away from the presence of the king. I don't want to hear what he has to say to me. There's church people just like that. It's Sunday. Oh, no. Last time I went, Pastor Gary, man, he read my mail. Huh. That's what the old timers used to call it. He read my mail, and I didn't like what he read. And so, see, some of you like living in your sin. And you have learned to come to church and play church and pretend everything's okay while you still live in your sin. Can I say it another way? It's like when you come to God's house and he speaks to your heart, but you don't like what he says. So what do? You stop coming to church. Or you start coming to church, but then you start, ignoring it in church. You don't like it when God deals with you about an area in your life that's unpleasing to God. You say, I'll show God. I'll stay away from the place where he speaks to me. I won't go to church. You're only hurting yourself. You're not hurting God. You think, I'll show God, I'll stay away from the place where he speaks to me. You think you're so smart by staying home, but friend, all you're doing is delaying your obedience. Amen. And let me say this to you. Delayed obedience is the same thing as disobedience. Can I explain that for a moment? Because see, you think, well, God, I know I got some things in my life. I know I got some areas. I know you've been speaking to me about something. And I know I need to get this taken care of. I know that, and you've talked to me. But God, I'm not ready to take care of that. I'm not ready to get, I don't want to lay that. It's a pleasure that I don't want to give up. And so God, here's what I'm going to, I will someday. You begin to make promises. God, tomorrow, or next week, next year. So what happens, it's January the 1st, 2000, whatever. And you stand up and you say, God, this year I'm going to change. This year, God, I'm going to take care of these things. This year, God, I'm going to get rid of those things in my heart that's not pleasing to you. And the next thing you know, it's December the 31st, 2000, same year, whatever. And you're still standing there going, God, I know I didn't get that out of my life. I know I didn't do what I told you I was going to, but next year, God, I'm going to do it. Next year, God, I'm going to take care of it next year. And the next thing you know, it's the end of the year again, and it's the end of the year again, and you're still carrying that same old baggage from year to year, and you're running from God. What you're doing is you're delaying your obedience, and you're thinking, hey, I can delay it, and I'm okay, friend, but delayed obedience is the same thing as disobedience. Same thing. It's just a prettier way for people to say it, so it makes them not feel so guilty because they're not dealing with the sins that's in their life. This is old school, isn't it? It's old school. It's Bible. It's Bible. Everything I'm preaching to you, I can show you here in the Word. So here's what happens. We say, well, you know what? I can't miss church. People are going to think something's wrong with me if I don't. See, I call you. I'll send you a text, or I'll say, hey, I miss you. Where you been? Oh, just had stuff going on. Just things. Okay. Well, don't forget where we're at. Come back. And all right, I'll be there. And they do. They come back. And yet, I get a kick out of this. I'm meddling. I know. This is what my daddy would say. Now, son, you've gone to meddling. People that haven't been in church in so long. And yet, when they come into church, you would act like they were right where they were when they left. Like nothing's ever changed. But I'm here to tell you, if I haven't been in the presence of God, I've missed week after week after week of being in his presence. The last thing I would do is come in and pretend like everything's okay. The first thing I would do is come in and say, God, forgive me for avoiding your presence. Forgive me, Lord, for not coming into your presence. And now, Lord, put me back in touch with you. But we come into church. And somehow a reason, somehow another, we've figured out, we know how we can make it through a service. It's like a game with people. And so during worship, what do? You clap. You're like, oh, listen, the drum's sounding good. Oh, Dave on that bass, man, he's playing that bass. Doom, 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 doom. And man, it's good. Listen to, oh, wow, Jesse's singing. Oh, I love that. Live Bones, Come Alive, Come Alive, Come. I love that. Oh, yeah, it's great. And you're listening to all that. And you're like really, some of you might even, ooh, yeah, getting into it. And you've learned how to listen to worship and not let it penetrate your heart. You've learned how, you've done it so long, you know how to set and act like everything is okay. And you listen to worship and it never touches your heart. And then the preaching comes. And what happens, here's what happens when the preaching comes. I can't wait to do this. So what do? Get my phone out. I got the Bible on here. It's not on the Bible, but I got my Bible on here. Let's see, I'm going to put a puzzle together. You're like, what? Quick story, I promise. One Wednesday night, the end of the service, Tynette. You're right. I come humbly to you and say, I'm sorry, you're right. It was the end of the service, had not dismissed. Pastor had preached, Pastor Larry had preached. And we had prayed, and there was a couple people that wanted to make a comment at the end of the service. And I knew sometimes that people's comments can turn into, you know, another message or something. And so I opened up my phone, and I just opened up a puzzle, and I started sitting and putting a puzzle together. Tynette sitting right behind me. That was Wednesday night. On Thursday night, Pastor Gary, this is Larry. Okay, what's up? I just got told that last night while the service was going on, you were on your phone playing a puzzle. It was at the end of the service. It doesn't matter. People saw you on the phone. You need to stay off your phone while the service is going on. Okay, you're the pastor. I do what you say. Okay, that might. Am I lying, Mom? That's the truth. Yeah, that's the truth. Listen to me. We try to entertain ourselves so we don't have to hear the preaching of the word. Oh, but I can do both. Or we don't have a phone or we don't have a tablet. Maybe somebody near us has got a kid we can play with. And I'll entertain myself with, here, I know it's not my child, but let me watch your child for the rest of the service because I really don't want to hear what he's about to say so I can entertain myself. I'm being a little facetious, but I'm being truthful today because we have learned to come to church and never be moved or touched by the preaching of the Word of God. When the whole service, God is screaming your name. God is saying, Jonah, go to Nineveh. But instead, you're like, I don't want to hear you, God. And when I'm ready to deal with the sin in my life, then I'll come and deal with you. But until then, I don't want to hear from you, God. And that's exactly what happened in Jonah's life. Jonah goes out, buys a ticket to Tarsus. Tarsus is 2,500 miles from Jerusalem that way. Nineveh is 500 miles that way from Jerusalem. So Jonah goes out, goes to Joppa, where the seaport is, buys a ticket, gets on the boat to go to Tarsus. Now, you know that the ticket to go to Tarsus cost him more than the ticket to go to Nineveh. I mean, that's 500 miles. That's 2,500 miles. That ticket, that's about a five-day journey that way. This is almost weeks he's going to be in this boat. I'm here to tell you, to outrun God or to run from what God is calling you will cost you more. And it will take more of your time and energy to run from God as if you were to run to God. Yeah. Ooh, I'm preaching better and you're shouting. That's why some people come to church, Austin, and they're exhausted. They're tired. I've had people tell me that. I'm so tired. Today I'm tired. You know why you're tired? It's because you're exhausted from running from the voice of God. You're running from God's call on your life. You're running from what God's called you to do. And you're running and running and running. And you come to church and you're exhausted. And God says this would be a whole lot easier if you would stop running and start submitting to what I told you to do. So Jonah enters the ship. Verse 4, chapter 1. But the Lord... Read that for me, Austin. What's it say? Sent what? Sent out what? The Lord sent the storm. It wasn't that the weather was messed up and the weatherman missed it. I stormed too. Oh, that's another storm. The seas were smooth. These men were professional sailors. They watched charts. They looked at the weather. They checked out the stars. They knew when you could travel on the sea and when you couldn't. And they said, we're going to Tarshish. And so they entered it. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, no one knew it. No one predicted it. Because God caused the storm to come up on the sea. And the boat began to rock. And the ship began to break up. And the men began to fear for their life. And the Bible says that they started praying to their own gods. To their own gods. So one was praying to Buddha, whatever. One was praying to Muhammad, whatever. One was praying to the god of the TV, I don't know. But they're praying to their own gods. Nobody was praying to the one true God. Jonah is in the bottom of the ship. He's asleep. The guy that's on the boat that's causing the storm is in the bottom of the boat and he's sleeping. He has no clue. See, people say, well, my sins and my running from God and my not being obedient to God isn't hurting anybody but me. Wrong, wrong, wrong. This ship and all 100, 150, 200 men on this ship, however many there is, they're about to all perish in a sea because Jonah is running from God. Don't tell me that your sin only affects you and nobody else, friend. You don't even know it. But did you know if you would be obedient to God's word in your life, that there are people who are waiting on the sidelines who will jump in and say, I've been waiting for you to get it right, and now that you got it right, I'll get it right too. Lead by example. Oh, that's not in the notes. I just threw that in. The captain of the ship, Pastor Bobby, the captain comes down, knocks on Jonah's door. Hey, Jonah, you might want to wake up. What do you mean? Well, there's a storm. And I'm sure when he wakes up, he begins to see now. Oh, yeah, there is. The ship's tossing. Yeah, maybe water coming in the cracks of his room. I don't know. There is. He goes, everybody's crying out to their gods, and nobody's God will answer. So why don't you cry out to your God, and maybe your God will be the God that answer. Yes. Jonah goes up on the top of the deck. Here's the men. They're rowing back towards the land. Got to get out of this storm. We got to get back. And they're like, we're praying. We're trying, God, hear us. And they're crying out to their God. And Jonah walks up there. But he does not repent. And he does not call out to his God. But he knew it was for his reason that the things they were. Meanwhile, the men are casting lots. They're saying, somebody's caused this storm. Somebody's the reason why we're in the storm. Somebody's at fault. Somebody's God is angry. I don't know whose God is angry, but somebody's God is angry. So we're going to cast lots And we're going to figure out whose God is angry, because wherever the lots fall, that's whose God is angry. And guess where they fell? On Jonah. And Jonah looks at him and says, "You're right. God spoke to me and told me to go to Nineveh. But I'm running from God. I went the opposite direction, and I'm going to Tarsus. But I'm here to tell you, if you will throw me overboard, the storm will cease." And the man's like, no, let's not do that. No, let's figure out something else. And they start throwing stuff overboard, cargo, start getting rid of stuff. See, here's what happens when God deals with us about something. Rather than removing what God told us to get rid of that will cause the peace in our life to come, we try to throw everything else overboard. We try to get rid of everything else thinking, hey, if I get rid of all of this, then everything will be all right. But God says, no, that's not how. Here's my word. And my word does not change. It's still the same. And my word is, Jonah, go to Nineveh. And Nineveh is still, Jonah is still going to Tarsus. And they finally said, there's nothing else we can do. In fact, the Bible says that Jonah did repent. He didn't repent to God. He repented to the men on the ship. He says, it's my fault. I'm sorry. And they picked him up and threw him overboard. And when they did, the storm ceased. Now, you would think Jonah is in the most dangerous place of his life now. He's out in the middle of a sea, in the depths of a sea. Land is nowhere near him. He's fish bait. He's food for the fish. And you would think that Jonah is in the worst place of his life. But I'm here to tell you, for once in Jonah's life, he's right smack dab in the middle of God's will. He's right where God wants him to be. He sent the fish that swallowed him. Some people call it a whale. The Bible just calls it a great fish. We call it a whale because to us the whale is the biggest fish, and that makes sense. Swallows him. There's something I want you to notice here that I never noticed before. That from the time God spoke to Jonah in chapter 1, until now, Jonah is swallowed and in the belly of a well. God never spoke to Jonah again until Jonah is in the belly of the well. God became silent. Oh, he was moving. He was causing things. He was stirring things, but he never spoke to Jonah again. But here's the flip side. Jonah never spoke to God again, until you get to chapter 3 and verse 1. But while he's in the belly of the fish, he has a lot of time to think about his life. Where did I go wrong? Maybe it's when you went on the boat to Tarsus and studying. Maybe it's when you walked out of the temple that day and said, I'm not listening to you, God, so don't talk to me anymore. How many married people here today? How many married people? Don't lift your hands for this, because we don't want to know your trouble. Dave's really happy to be married. He's got both hands up. Or was you just lifting your hands because Denise didn't want anybody else to know that? So you. Tammy and I will go down the road. How come the worst fight sometimes you have is in the car? It's like there's a road rage spirit on the highways that gets inside the car. And the problem is, I wish Tammy was here. She's working today. But I wish she was here. She would tell you that the problem is that you can't do nothing about it because you're stuck in the car. I mean, you're driving down the road, and you can't do nothing about it. So here's the driver and driving, and here's Tammy just quiet, staring at the windshield. Just keep talking. I'm not listening to you. You can talk all day, but speak to the hand because the ear's not listening to you. There are a lot of people in the church just like that. Because God spoke to you and you refuse to listen to what God says. And so God says, and until you get into my will and you start submitting to my obedience and my direction in your life, I'm going to be silent. And you're doing all the talking. And God's like, just keep talking. I'm not listening to you. You ain't got nothing to say to me. Jonah was silent. And here's the neat thing. Chapter 2, verse 10. Don't have to turn there. But it says that the fish, oh, you did. Very good. Look into it. The Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto dry ground. You need to understand, there's only two ways out of a fish. So I think God was pretty nice to Jonah. How many agree that God did Jonah a favor? Maybe if Jonah wouldn't have submitted to God's will and said, God, okay, I'll go to Nineveh, maybe his exit would have been the other end of the fish. How many's ever thought of that before? There's only two ways out of a fish. And he spit him up on the ground. And the very next verse was the verse in our text. Chapter 3, verse 1. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah. What? The second time. He came to him, chapter 1, and said, go to Nineveh. But now there's been silence. Now there's been nothing. And now he spit out up on dry ground, and God says, no, Jonah, I'm going to speak to you again. And what I told you 3 or 4 days ago is still the same thing I say to you today. I have not changed my message. I have not changed my word. I still want you to go to Nineveh. I still want you to preach the gospel. So, friend, the longer you wait, running from God is not going to change his mind. He's not going to say, I know I told you that was a sin and you need to get rid of that in your life. And I know you ran from me and you don't want to hear me and you stopped coming to church and then you came back, but you ignored me. You don't want to hear me. And so I've decided now that you're back and you don't have to do what I said originally. The word of the Lord to Jonah is still the same word to Jonah. God's word will never return void. So this message today is a message of the second chance. You see what happened? I got preaching here, got away from my notes, and I messed out a piece of stuff I wanted to talk about. Because see, the whole idea is I want to do it or I'm willing to do it. Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh. David did not want to fight Goliath. But he was willing to fight Goliath. The three Hebrew children did not want to go into the fiery furnace, but they were willing to go into the fiery furnace. Daniel did not want to go into the lion's den, but he was willing to go into the lion's den. Abraham did not want to sacrifice his son Isaac. He'd waited so long to get this promised child. He did not want to sacrifice him, but he was willing to sacrifice him. Let's bring it to the New Testament. Jesus Christ himself in the Garden of Gethsemane said, let this cup pass from me. He did not want to go to the cross. In fact, he said, the flesh is weak, but my spirit is willing, hallelujah. You may not want to do what God tells you to do. You may not want to submit to what God says to do. But friend, it doesn't matter if you want to do it. What matters is, are you willing to do it, hallelujah? Are you willing? Because I'm here to tell you, if you keep running from God, you keep living in disobedience, There will never be comfort. You'll never have peace. In fact, to run from God and to be disobedient to God is haunting. Is haunting. It's a scary place to be. But once you submit to God's will for your life, once you say, God, you spoke to me, I know that that's an area in my life you told me I need to get rid of. I could have really been mean today. I could have, if I wanted to be in the flesh and be harsh, I could have exposed what God has spoke to my heart about some things that's in this church. I'm hoping I can do it generically enough that while I'm preaching this, you'll sit there and say, he's talking to me because God told me to get rid of this and I have not done it. God's speaking to you today, friend. See, I told you, some of you that were amening the loudest a while ago wouldn't be saying anything by the end of the message. These are not the kind of sermons you preach and win friends and influence people. They're not popular. But I'm not a popular person anyway. I'm not seeking popularity. I'm seeking his approval. Listen to me. So Jonah did exactly what God said. He went to Nineveh. And Nineveh was so big, it takes literally 3 days to walk from one side of it to the other side of it. And in the first day, he walked about a third of the way through it. And the whole time he walked, he was preaching, thus saith the Lord. And the city of Nineveh began to repent. And those men and women began to turn their hearts over to God. And God made a difference. So can I talk to you today as the worship team comes back to the platform? And you're like, oh, okay, here's the other part of what I was going to say a while ago. See, with the end of the, you've made it through the worship. You've made it through the preaching. Now it's the altar call. Can't look at the pastor. Because if those eyes hit my eyes, I know he's speaking to me. Can't look at the pastor. My stomach. Oh, I better go to the bathroom. Or some of you have been sitting there, you're going, oh, this is going to hurt. I came in here about 9:45. I haven't had a cigarette in over an hour. Oh, I need to go get a cigarette. So I'm going to go out and have my smoke before all the church people come out and see me outside smoking. It's been nice knowing you guys. It really has. The altar call. We're at that time of the service that is probably the most serious time of all the service. This is the time where God is putting your life on the scale of life. And he's weighing it. And he's saying, oh, wait a minute, you've been found wanting. In other words, there's an area in your life that God's speaking to you about. Don't walk out of here today running away from God. See, that's what you do. You're not getting on a boat going to Tarsus, but you're walking out the door away from what God's calling you to. The God of second chances. I want to end with this, because that's what the sermon was supposed to be about. The God of second chances. For Jonah, he not only spared the life of Jonah, but he also gave Jonah another chance. But he wasn't the only one who got a second chance. How about the men on the ship? The ship was sinking. The ship was breaking apart. They're about to perish in the sea. But when they threw Jonah over, the sea calmed, and so they got a second chance. How about the people in Nineveh? If Jonah would have never gone. And he didn't. But when he finally went, they had a second chance. How about David? David was a murderer and an adulterer. We would have been through with David. If he'd have been a member of the Assemblies of God, they'd have thrown him out, took his credentials and said, hey, you better start selling bricks or something because you're not going to be a preacher no more. But God said, I'm not through with you, David, and gave him a second chance. I could go on and I could go on and I could go on and I could tell you of other people. Isn't that what the Bible's about? Isn't that basically what the scripture is? It shows us that we serve a God of the second chance. I don't know who of you here blowed it, but I've blowed it. I blowed it, and I wasn't on a ship to Tarsus, but I was sitting outside of the church, not in the will of God, but running from the will of God. And God put me in a place where he could speak to me. It's called Alton Memorial Hospital. It was 3 days after Christmas, 2011. And God said to me, I got you where I want you. You can't, there's nothing to distract you, no other voices. And he began to talk to me and tell me, you're running from the call that I've got on your life. He didn't tell me something I didn't already know. But he just reminded me that he hadn't forgotten about me. On a Sunday morning, just a few weeks later, I came to the front of this church because there was people in this church, my mama, my brother, Uncle Dave, Aunt May, and others in this church that said, we're not giving up on you. Sherry Thomas said, we're not giving up on you. And they prayed for me. And I'm so thankful that I serve the God of the second chance. I'm going to say something. I'm going to say it very carefully because I don't want to go off into details. But you don't know where, some of you don't know where I came from, but I'm telling you, I was a pastor and I messed up, and I messed up big time. I mean, when I did it, I did it right. I royally did it. I messed up. And by most people's standards, I would be through. I would be done. But the God that I serve says, I'm not done with you. You may have made some mistakes. You may have went left when I wanted you to go right. You may have done some things I'm not glad that you did. But quit running from them. Put them behind. Stop running from your past and start running towards your future. If you'd have told me in January of 2012 that I would be standing here today, 5 years later, and I would be the pastor of this church, I would tell you, you're the craziest person I've ever met in my life. Because I never thought that God would ever use somebody like me again. But he's the God of the second chance. And let me tell you, he's not just the God of the second chance. He's the God of the third chance and the fourth chance and the fifth chance and the sixth chance and the seventh chance and the eighth chance and the ninth chance and the tenth. How many of you have messed up more than once, more than twice, more than three times, more than, I mean, he's always there. Because we serve the God who does not fail. Hallelujah. Go ahead, Oz. So here's the altar call today. You're here. And there's a voice speaking to you today. There's a voice speaking to you today. And he's saying to you, I'm speaking to you. Now you think this message was for those around you, but God's saying to you, this message was for you. For you. So don't pass it off to the guy behind you or don't shove it down the road to the people on the other side of you. God says this message is for you. And he says to you today, I don't care where you've been. I don't care what you've done. I don't care how bad you've messed up. You think you can never be used again, but I'm here to tell you, God says, I'm the God of the second chance. And I'm willing and ready to speak to you again. I'm ready to speak to you again. Will you listen? Will you listen? I'm going to ask you to stand this morning.